So you have to come out of all that in a dignified manner. Sometimes I'm sitting in an office and an actress or actor, they're sitting there and they're chit-chatting, hand-slapping and everything, and I'll just sit quietly. But when they'll talk to me, they would often ask me some questions. I would respond to them. But again, in a dignified way. So what do you do about your outlook? What are the important aspects to be covering? How you dress up is very important. Your dress has to be decent. Modest dress. Your hijab has to be in right place. I've seen many bloggers with a camel hump. If you are having a camel hump, if you're wearing tight jeans, short shirt, yes, a scarf, it's not appropriate. It's not appropriate. Because of the media need and the camera needs, I have to sometimes wear colored scarves and even colored abayas. But I make sure they are modest in outlook, in dress up. At least you at your end have to make the right effort. How much makeup do you wear? If you're in front of the cameras, because you have to do puffing. You have to have a certain amount of makeup on your face. Even when I'm wearing niqab. Because there's such strong lights, they're hitting your face, that you have to do the base. But how much do you do it? And if otherwise you're working, you should never be in your makeup when you're fully exposed like that. Similarly, jewelry. What kind of jewelry you wear? Everything has to be taken into consideration. Then free mixing culture. It's everywhere. It's in our houses, in our colleges, universities, workplaces. Then we have to have controlled conversation. Controlled. And that reminder you have to give yourself every day. Every day you have to tell yourself, this is what I can do, this is what I can't do. You have to learn to look down. Rather than looking into the eyes of the people. You have to have a mahram somehow engaged in those systems. Like let's say you are having, you're young and you have email and groups. And if you feel that these people are taking advantage of you one way or the other, that's what you have to do. I'm actually sitting in places in the office of a director or a producer and they have ordered pizza and food and I have to be there. I can't say, main to ja rahi hu, astaghfirullah, kya kar rahe hain aap log? Because I'm working with them. But then, how do I sit? How do I present myself? In some places, when I'm working for a longer period of time, they would assign me a room. Ma'am, aapka ye room hai. You can go there, you can relax, and you can have your food. Because then I'm working for 3-4 programs for 5 hours, 6 hours. But sometimes, we have to keep sitting there because we're just working on one program or two programs and then you're so tired and exhausted, you want to have a meal and there is no other place. Everywhere there are men. So how do you eat with your niqab? You have to practice that. If you're not even wearing niqab, how do you like be part of that group but in a dignified manner? Don't go overboard with your hijab, niqab, cracking jokes and talking to them in the same manner. I even learned to control my laughter on the show, my expressions on the show. Mujhe hansi bahut aadat hai jaldi. Sometimes I have seen that when I have a guest with me, now I'm anchoring many shows. So I sometimes make a statement and my guest would laugh. And I have female guests over there. So then I have to sort of tell them that, you know, next time when I say something, you should not laugh. You have to control your laughter. Then the delivery of the content is also very important. You have to convey things with the right aqeedah. Have you studied aqeedah before you enter into media, mainstream media? Are you a student of Quran and Sunnah? A good grip on the right aspect, the simple language that you use, and the rational thinking appeal has to be there. And this is like mainstream media. Now people don't have stamina. If you talk like that, they will switch off. They will turn off their channel. You want them to listen to your speech. Use a very natural style, not a stiff body style. Give Quran and Hadith in such a manner that people can understand all those concepts. Third important area, as we said, was whims and desires. Again, every day you have to be a Quran student. Every day you have to ask yourself how many sunnahs I practiced. You need to have a friend appointed who can watch media, especially when you are there, and keep telling you, you're changing, you're sticking to the right aspect. And unless you do that, you are going to be in a lot of trouble. Other important aspects to cover, right modeling. In many platforms, you are going to be the only person, the only religious person they are exposed to. The Muslim person they know. A girl who is coming from a good university, good background. So you have to give them a good picture of deen. This is your role modeling. How you eat, how you talk, how you interact with them. They're learning from you. Then again, as I said, Quran and Sunnah. This is your only salvation anywhere, but especially if you're in media. Then you have to see your intention. Every day you have to tell yourself, am I doing it for my glamour, for my success? Badi hit saiye, badi like saiye. Now I'm going to make money. I'm going to invite anyone on my YouTube channel so that everyone gets attracted to me. They will come on my channel. These are heavyweight magnets. You're not inviting me or A, B, C, big figures because you want people to benefit from them. You want to attract more audience to your channel. This intention is wrong. Intention has to be, I invite the right person for the right work. And yes, you have to stay committed. You know, there are very few people who fulfill their commitments. So my intention is the message should be going to them. Next thing is, what kind of entertainment you need to work on? Healthy entertainment, not trashy. Authenticity has to be your priority. I've seen people drift away just to engage people and bring them the softer image of Islam. You present anything and everything. I'm so sorry. Don't do that. Never ever do that. You have to be going by Quran and Sunnah. A lot of issues are expanded in a very wrong direction. Like dramas and plays that you see, they would make you filled with anger towards parents, towards society, how women are being treated, but they will never tell you because you are breaking the limitation set by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is why you are in this trouble. There is no proactivity shown. In a play, they would show you there is a girl because the father and the mother, they were not agreeing and she had to go and marry the guy herself, court marriage karli. But they will never tell you why did she talk to that guy? Why she was not in the right limitation of haya and hijab? They will give you mixed ideologies. So you have to have Quran and Sunnah as scanner in your life. They will show you that this girl was raped. But they will never tell you that why did they have mixed gathering in the home? Why this girl was getting so free with these cousins or other male which are not mahram members in the family? They will never show you this. They will never show you the right approach that is there in our deen. So ethics are not conveyed in the right manner. So remember this verse. I'll finish off with this. Surah Al-A'raf, verse number 33. قُلْ إِنَّمَا حَرَّمَ رَبِّيَ الْفَوَاحِشَ مَا ظَهَرَ مِنْهَا وَمَا بَطَنْ وَالْإِثْمَ وَالْبَغْيَ بِغَيْرِ الْحَقِّ وَأَنْ تُشْرِكُوا بِاللَّهِ مَا لَمْ يُنَزِّلْ بِهِ سُلْطَانًا وَأَنْ تَقُولُوا عَلَى اللَّهِ مَا لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. Say, my Lord has only forbidden immoralities, which is apparent of them, and what is concealed, and in sin and oppression without right, and that you associate with Allah, that for which He has not sent down authority, and that you say about Allah, that which you do not know. So whatever we do not know, we have to have this clarity, this vision, and then move on into this media and benefit people. And convey the right content. Otherwise, we are only leaving it for the trashy thought, mixed up ideologies, wrong belief system. And it is badly affecting our youth, the ladies, domestic ladies who are sitting at home. I would like to answer the student because she had a very valid question. That most of us or if you look at the younger generation now, they are glued to entertainment and they would go for anything which is entertaining. And that is why you will see many even bloggers and YouTubers, what they're doing is they're trying to make funny Islamic content or these clips so that they can somehow attract. If you ask me honestly, I have seen over years that Quran and Sunnah has to be conveyed in an effective manner as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam delivered. Many times when we say that we live in a different society, if you study Seerah, you will find out the society where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam introduced oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the reality of this life and how to focus, how to have a vision in this life, it was society with similar kind of challenges as we have. You can't expect results overnight. You have to now change the taste of the people. Their taste is actually totally transformed. They cannot take anything serious, anything which is giving us serious outlook towards life. So gradually, if you keep modifying and bringing them back to the right religion. And for me, I always stand by the same principle. I would talk about religion and I would present it in a way that people are interested. I'm not going to make it funny where it's not needed, just because I will get a lot of hits and likes. Because if I present it properly, the barakah is going to come from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I think in these times, these concepts sound very strange. Because we feel like, how will this happen? So you have to be smart. You have to understand the society today. And then you also have to have a good grip over religion and then convey the message. If you start working now when you're my age, then you will feel and see the difference in the society. You have to start putting stop to the wrong practices, inshallah. Okay, this is a question. How to gather that courage to step into this world full of efforts to make a change and to make ourselves ready for criticism? For one thing, learn the soft skills. Have the passion from Quran and Sunnah, if it is your goal, if it is your mission, and then you rise above your own self. You are doing it for Deen, for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for your Akhirah. So then the criticism and everything you can put aside. And yes, take baby steps. Don't try to take giant leaps. You learn a new thing every day, and based on that, you reach a certain status when you're able to convey things in a more confident manner.
She has heard the opinion that we should go to media to clear all the concepts and negative thoughts. But the problem is that as women, we should take care of our voice also. There is hijab of voice, and non-mahram should not hear the voice of women. So how can we be modest in that situation? And how can we go to media when we have this order from Allah? So it's a very good question. Jazakallah khair for asking. The first thing is that people, when they say women's voice is also, they have parda for their voice, or it should not be heard by non-mahram men. Basically, it's a misconception. Not in every case. There are exceptional cases when women should not be heard by men, like when they are singing or when they are reading Quran with tarteel, reading Quran in hadar, when you don't make your voice so much beautiful. You can easily do that in front of men. So a girl can recite Quran where as male professors are sitting over here, but she should not use more tarteel at that time. The verse that is taken from Quran, and people claim that a women's voice is parda in every case, the verse exactly says that in some cases women can be heard by non-mahram men. وَقُلْنَا قَوْلًا مَعْرُوفًا, that they should not talk to men in an unchaste manner or in a manner that give the men hope or the people who have disease in their heart hope about that women, that maybe she can have some romantic relationship with me. And in the end, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that women should talk to men in a business-like manner, in a tone that is known between the two people who are exchanging the innocent thoughts, or they have some exchange of words, right? When you talk to the bus driver, when you talk to the gardener, you talk to the milkman, if someone comes and rings the doorbell, you ask, who is there, and you talk to them and you tell them your brother or father is not at home, it means women, not in every case that women should not be heard by men. Also, the woman who is giving you dars about Surah An-Nur, she is not saying anything wrong. She can be heard by non-mahram men. But we always encourage non-mahram men not to listen female scholars, but they should listen to the male scholars. Because in a lecture, I can talk to you. In a question-answer session, brief question-answer session, I can talk to you. But when it comes to the long details, I don't want to indulge into fitna. So the basic thing is that when we have recorded something, it is the basic etiquette for men not to listen to that so much.
Okay, there is a question. What would you advise to the girl who also want to be a part of media and convey the message of Islam? Most of the parents do not allow their daughters to choose this field. So what would they do in that case? So it could be parents, it could be even husband. I know some of ladies who are very talented, but their husbands or their families, they're not comfortable for them to be in media. I have given you a lot of forums related to media. If you feel that they wouldn't allow you to be in front of the camera, you can work behind the camera. If they don't want you to be part of the any channel, you can always be a blogger yourself, or you can always be a writer somewhere. So there are multiple platforms that you can use and multiple manners in which you can be beneficial in media. Or you could be just an audience who is writing analytic articles related to that. Basically, what you have to do is you have to modify your target, the same targets, but meet them in a different manner. It is very, very important that you don't rebel. Remember, if you rebel against your husband or your parents, there is not going to be any barakah in your work. And that means Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants you to do something else. And there are other ways of, again, approaching the same issue.
Why should we go into such professions where you can be harassed? If your motive is to spread Islamic teaching, there are many other ways to do so. Mm-hmm. Basically, I think if you have heard Dr. Kawal carefully, she already talked about it, and she said not every woman will go to every place. Like, some women will fly the planes, but not every woman will do that. There are women who will go to the places where other women cannot reach. Women who can handle the situation without being harassed, and they can serve Islam in media, they should go there. Here we are talking about the women are already taking part in mainstream media, in an alternative media. And what we said is that when you are in alternative media, we are not telling you to all of you to go there. We are saying that when you are in alternative media, keep these limits. And Dr. Kawal has told you about when you are in mainstream media, these are the challenges that you are going to face. And these are the practical ways to come out of those challenges. We are not forcing you to go there. If you are a shy girl in the beginning of your 20s or in the end of your teens, of course we cannot think that you will be a public speaker, or sometimes you will be a famous writer. But in 30s or 40s, you will feel that it is essential to come out for your society to save the humanity around you. And this is a process that you will take, and in the end you will learn the same thing that other women are doing. The point is that if you are already in blogging, if you are already in vlogging, if you are already there on social media, then use it in a positive way according to the limits prescribed by Sharia. We are not telling the shy girls to essentially go there and put themselves into fitna. We are saying that if you got the opportunity, remember the limits and then do the service to Islam. Otherwise, you don't need to go necessarily into all these things.
Whenever any TV drama wants to show somewhat orthodox or conventional idea, they can call the girl's name, Umme Kalsoom, Umme Maryam, is it correct? You know, these are all subliminal messages and ideologies which are transmitted. As such, there is apparently nothing wrong with that. But when they are using these names, you need to be very cautious. You need to have your analytic skills, analytic thought and belief system on high alert. And similar kind of a question, some ulama use strict statements about using or taking hijab as a part of haya modesty. And some girls go against it, against this strictness, or rebel against this strictness. Basically, what do you call strictness? If there is a scholar who is giving us principles according to Quran and Sunnah, so then we need to have acceptability. If I'm not able to digest something which is given to me from Quran and Sunnah and I call it strict, that is not appropriate. Okay, if there is something which is given out in the name of Islam and it is not there from Quran and Sunnah, it is going in another extreme direction, you don't have to rebel. You don't have to revolt to that extent. Because in living in these times, we say, okay, you can live with your thought and I can live with my thought. So we also need to again look at those people, their background, where they learned it from. We should just give them margin and stick to what we have learned from Quran and Sunnah. Not go from one extreme to another extreme. Another question is the concept of modesty related to media industry whenever it is in when it's in their favor? No, modesty is everywhere, but again, why are we talking about media? Because the focus is on media these days and a lot of youngsters are heading towards that direction. So we want them to make wiser choices. Next question. How do we tell people about modesty who do not share the same values and beliefs as us, like non-Muslims? As the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam narrated, stated, how it is there in Quran, how we beautifully represent ourselves as well as the picture of Islam. Why is the sense of modesty associated with women only in media? No, it is not just women. Modesty goes for everyone, all the Muslims, as it is part of Iman. But we have to accept this fact that women are more attractive than males. See, our deen goes an extra mileage for women to be more covered and more in those parameters, because we have seen when women, like if I am controlled, all the men will stay controlled. When men, they are trying to talk to me, but they're not getting any space, so they don't have any option. So if women control, they can set better example. But having said that, modesty standards are also for men. They also need to practice, but who is going to teach them? Us again. When we practice it, they go in their limitation. I had been professional, not working in media at that time when I was not wearing hijab, but I was a doctor and I'm working with male members as well, male colleagues as well. And I see marked difference in their attitude, how they talk to me, the same men, how they interact with me, how they give me space when I am walking or sitting somewhere, when I was not covered and when I'm covered. So there are certain facts which we have to accept rather than against revolt against them. Jab main cover nahi karti thi to main bhi aisi baatein karti thi. Jab tak maine Quran nahi padha tha, I also used to make similar statement. Why do I have to cover? Mardon ko burqa pehnai na? They have sick dirty mind. I don't. But when I studied Quran, I realized Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us some ground rulings for a purpose, for a reason, and we must appreciate that.
Barakallahu fikum. Islam is very vast religion. We have, like, it's a code of conduct, as she said, that you have manners for drinking water and you have the manners how to wear clothes. So she says that, I personally think that people are bored of constantly listening in the same monotonous things about Islam, which is the main cause of their disinterest in religion. Basically, the problem is that God's religion would not be affected with our disinterest. There is a huge difference between the content created by the born Muslims on unconventional media or non-traditional media and the content created by the revert Muslims. Why is that difference? Because some people are taking interest in the religion of God, whereas some people are forgetting God. People from the family of the Prophet ﷺ who refuse to accept Islam. And there are people from far, far Africa who came to Medina just to search about the Prophet ﷺ. So remember that some people would make every sacrifice to reach to the religion of God, whereas some other people will listen to the word of God and then they click and they will move to another page where they will watch an item song. Because definitely for them, item song is more interesting than the verses of God. Does that mean that disinterest of people is going to kill the message of God? No. From time of Adam alayhi salam to the time of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam till 2019, we know that there are people who will follow the right thing. And they will always be minority. I mentioned you the verse where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَإِن تَتَوَلَّوْ يَسْتَبْدِلْ قَوْمًا غَيْرَكُمْ. If you will turn away from your religion, Allah is going to change and bring a nation in place of you. ثُمَّ لَا يَكُونُ أَمْثَالَكُمْ. And that nation will not be like you, disobedient and ungrateful. So if something is not interesting for us, this does not mean that other people are not taking interest into that. This is how we are confusing other Muslims. So our disinterest is not going to harm anyone except us. Is modesty only about covering yourself, and how to promote modesty without offending others, like making them angry? Basically, I would say that you need to work on your self-esteem. Have you ever thought about how can I go to university without offending anyone on the face of earth? Have you ever thought about it? No, you came to university just because you want to study. Right? Whereas there are plenty of people inside Pakistan who are against university education. But you still came to university. Why? Because you don't care. But when it comes to the promotion of modesty, you say, I don't want to offend anyone, you know. Means it's the problem with self-esteem. It's not the problem with modesty. It's not the problem with society. If today I start wearing tight jeans in the campus and I stop wearing abaya, not everyone will be happy from me. So whatever you do, there will be some critics. You need to know where you stand and you need to work on yourself. This should be known that you cannot be a hijabi blogger with full eye makeup, with smoky eyes, and you tell others, let me tell you in my full niqab how to make smoky eyes, you know. Don't do it. Don't follow such girls. Also, she said, is modesty about covering yourself? Modesty is not about only covering yourself. Both men and women should lower their gaze if they are like in presence of non-mahrams, or if they are in front of something that should not be watched. So modesty is also when you are looking at screens, inappropriate thing appears, you should lower your gaze. Modesty is in being chaste before marriage and after marriage. Not having secret friends, as we mentioned, muttakhizi akhdan and muttakhazat akhdan. Modesty is also in covering your body in the manner Allah has told you. Modesty is also in choosing nikah over zina. Modesty is also in going out in full hijab when Allah has ordered you, wherever Allah has ordered you to be in full hijab. Modesty is also in choosing the right halal professions. And modesty is in following everything that is halal and abstaining everything that is haram. So this is the easiest thing that you can remember forever. That modesty is in following everything that is halal and abstaining from everything that is haram or makruh or disgusted in Islam.
So I'll finish off with that. Subhanakallahumma wa bihamdika ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.